Many people have beliefs about the end times, such as the rapture, a 7-year tribulation period, the Antichrist, and the millennial reign, but they don't understand these individual beliefs are part of a large theological system called dispensationalism, the popular modern view of prophecy. Many people believe there's going to be a rapture, but don't know why there will be one. Many people believe there will be a 7-year tribulation period, but they don't really know what the purpose of a tribulation period is. This is the view I was taught and which is widely proclaimed on Christian television, radio, and in bookstores. For many, it is the gospel and there is no other truth or way to view the scriptures in future. However, I began to see these things in a different light. During my time of searching, I learned about the different views of eschatology that the church has believed and taught throughout its history that I never knew existed. Those of amillennialists, historic premillennialists, postmillennialists, historicists, preterists and idealists. I was shocked. You may have never heard of any other views before, but the church has not always believed the dispensational view. In fact, of all the views of eschatology, that is the youngest. So I began to see that the Bible was not dispensational, but covenantal, and it revolved around the different covenants God made with various people. I also began to see that most of the biblical passages that many see as future were fulfilled in the first century. This is the view I have come to understand that the scriptures teach, a covenant eschatology. As I began to study these things and seek for myself the truth of what the Bible teaches concerning the last days, there were 4 major keys that had a hand in my journey from being a dispensationalist to accepting more of a covenant eschatology view. 1. The biblical last days. 2. Biblical hermeneutics. 3. The present reality of the kingdom of God. 4. Israel and the church. 1. The biblical last days. Understanding Old Covenant Israel and their last days is the first key to understanding eschatology. Many of the end time prophecies given by the Old Testament prophets were delivered to Israel, not to the church. Many of the words of Jesus about the end and judgment were spoken directly to Israel. In fact, much of the prophecy of the scriptures could be described as Jewish eschatology because it was dealing with God's covenant people Israel and their last days as God was fulfilling Old Testament prophecies and promises made to them. The New Testament writers living in the first century believed they were living in the last days. What they were in the last days of was not the world, but the end of something specific, an age. The Romans, in AD 70, utterly destroyed Jerusalem, killed over 1 million Jews, and leveled the temple with its priesthood and sacrifices. To the Jews, this event was the end of their world, and would happen in the lifetime of those living in Jesus' day. Jesus, himself, predicted this event would happen. It was no secret, and it was something the early believers warned others about. So biblical and covenantal eschatology is not so much about the end of the world as it is the end of the Old Covenant Age of the Mosaic Law, and the beginning of the New Covenant Age through the finished work of Jesus Christ. These were the biblical last days, which have already come and gone. 2. Biblical hermeneutics. Hermeneutics is the art of interpreting Scripture. It is the systematic rules and ways to properly understand the Bible. We all do hermeneutics even when we don't realize it. Whenever we read a scripture and interpret it, we are using this tool. The problem is that many people have never been taught the proper way to hermeneutically interpret scripture, and this leads to misinterpretations. The more I learned about hermeneutics, the more I was exposed to the historical particulars surrounding the scripture. The more I learned of the nature of scripture, the more my former view of eschatology didn't line up anymore. The main point of hermeneutics is to exegete the scriptures. Exegesis means to draw out of what is in the scriptures. It's finding out what the author meant to convey to the original audience to which he was writing. This is opposed to exegesis, which is reading into the scriptures something that is not there. When we exegete scripture, we usually look at it from our point of view and place a modern-day meaning on a text which was not originally present in the text itself. On the other hand, when we exegete scripture, we look at it from the original audience's point of view so we can understand what the original writer meant. Some other crucial components of biblical hermeneutics are audience relevance. A foundational principle in hermeneutics is that the Bible was not originally written to us, but it was written for us. The Apostle Paul wrote a letter to the church at Corinth addressing real issues that were happening in that church. His thinking and intent on those particular issues didn't go thousands of years into the future. Rather, the letter was intended for them, for their time, and their issues. Now, where there are similar circumstances or moral exhortations, we can conclude that God's word to them is God's word for us as well. However, while the scripture is profitable for all, we shouldn't expect everything that was said to them to come to pass in our day. Covenant understanding. The Bible is a book about covenants, and if we don't understand the timing and nature of covenants, then we will inevitably misunderstand and misapply Scripture. There are five major covenants in Scripture: Noahic, Abrahamic, Mosaic, the Law, Davidic, and the New Covenant. One misunderstanding is that since the Gospels are in the New Testament, that means they are part of the New Covenant. However, when Jesus spoke and ministered to the Jews in the Gospels, the Old Covenant law was still in effect. The New Covenant didn't begin until after his death and resurrection. We must understand which part of the Bible we are reading and which covenant the people were under in a specific passage or book. Context. Finding the context of a book or passage is crucially important. There are two contexts to keep in mind when reading Scripture: the historical context, who was the book written to, who was it written by, when was it written, what type of genre is it, what are the situations surrounding the book, And what did the words mean to the original audience? For instance, when we understand the historical particulars surrounding the churches Paul addressed in his letters, we can better understand why Paul said what he did. Then and only then can we properly apply these ancient texts to our day. Next, the biblical context. Too many times we take one scripture and lift it out of the others around it to make it say something that the author did not mean. We must keep the text in context and read the verses before and after so that we don't misinterpret a passage or scripture. Apocalyptic language. The Bible is not one book, but a collection of 66 books written by different authors under different circumstances in different forms or genres. The Bible contains history, wisdom, poetry, narrative, prophecy, parables, and letters. One of the forms of ancient literature was called apocalyptic literature. Apocalyptic language used cosmic metaphors and symbols to convey national wars, judgments, and disasters. Images like stars falling, the sun not shining, the moon turning into blood, and clouds rolling up. It also used animals to speak of people, rulers, and nations. You might recall seven-headed beasts, locusts with men's faces, and a lamb slain. These images are never meant to be taken literally, but symbolically to convey a message in a cryptic way. Original languages. The Bible was not written in English. The Old Testament was primarily written in Hebrew, and the New Testament in Greek. Knowing the original languages or knowing how to use helps and tools to understand them can be very helpful. For example, you may be familiar with the four different Greek words that we translate as love: philia, storge, eros, and agape. Well, just like there are different Greek words for one English word love, there are also different words concerning eschatology. The word world in English can be translated as cosmos, cosmic world, ion, a particular age, and oikomen, the inhabited earth, also used in reference to the Roman Empire. When the disciples asked Jesus about the end of the world, Matthew 24:3, they were literally asking when the end of the ion age would be, not the cosmos world. If one mistranslates that word in Matthew 24, then the whole chapter will be misinterpreted. Intertextuality. This is the biblical writer's practice of quoting, alluding to, or echoing scriptures from other parts of the Bible. It's amazing how many times the New Testament writers quoted the Old Testament. Truly, the narrative of the New Testament is rooted and grounded in the Old. This is very important when trying to understand prophecy. The Bible will interpret the Bible. We don't have to look to the newspapers or news networks. If you observe the quotes and allusions to Old Testament passages, you will begin to see the prophetic picture come together. There are almost 400 allusions to Old Testament scriptures in the book of Revelation alone. So, we can conclude that if you want to understand the book of Revelation from a covenantal viewpoint, then you have to know the intertextuality in the scriptures. 3. The present reality of the kingdom. I began to study about the kingdom of God, which was about the transformation of society. The kingdom view was optimistic. It declared the power of God available today, and it was centered on the victory of the gospel. The view I previously held was pessimistic and declared that the church was going to get weaker and weaker, that the devil was going to win out in the world, and that our only hope was to be raptured off the planet. The message of the kingdom really resonated with me. It resonated with my passion to see people change, to see my city change, to see the world change, and to give people a future and a hope. The difference between these two views led me to make a choice. Was everything going to get worse and worse, or better and better? Was I trying to escape the world or change the world? Would the church lose or would the church win? I knew in my heart that I couldn't be kingdom and dispensational. I chose kingdom. 4. Israel and the Church. This topic was the straw that broke it for me. I still had a lot of reservations about kingdom theology, but when God opened my eyes to the truth surrounding Israel and the church, it was over. My choice was clear. The very heart and core of dispensationalism is that there are currently two covenant people of God, national Israel, God's chosen people who have a covenant with God, and the church, God's people who also have a covenant with God. In order for dispensationalism to work, these two groups must be distinct and separate. However, I began to see that the New Testament teaches something totally different. When I saw that the Bible teaches that there are not two covenant people of God, but only one, I could no longer accept the dispensational view of eschatology. It's important for the one to know what they believe, but it's more important for the one to know why they believe it. I also want to give an alternative to fear-based Christianity accompanied by paranoia over everything that happens in the world. Many people have heard stories of a soon coming World War III and Battle of Armageddon, and all the Christians being sucked into the sky in the twinkling of an eye. They have no expectation for the future because some in the church have told them that their only hope is being raptured out. Jesus Christ did give us hope for the world, but it isn't an escape route. It's Christ in us, the hope of glory. God's plan isn't for the church to escape earth and go to heaven. It's for the church to bring heaven to earth. For those of you who are on a journey like I was, maybe you have only been taught one way, and that's what you currently believe. So this is my journey out of mainstream pop Christian culture with its left behind books, prophecy speculations, and impending rapture dreams and movies. I wanted to show you the path and questions that brought me to what I believe is a more proper understanding of biblical prophecy. I wanted to introduce you to prophecy that is not filled with monsters and dragons, nuclear bombs, falling airplanes and disappearing people, but to one that spoke to the first hearers of the prophecies themselves and meant something to them, prophecy that lines up with history and gives hope for the future, while proclaiming a victorious gospel and Savior.